Good afternoon, everyone. Fellow classmates, friends, family, and faculty, welcome to the 2017 Class Day Exercises. My name is Rhea Patel. I live in Kirkland House. And it is my greatest honor to serve as the first marshal of the class of 2017. First, I'd like to give a huge thank you to the members of the Senior Class Committee for their boundless energy and dedication that has strengthened our community as we prepare to leave Harvard's gates. I'd also like to thank the Harvard Alumni Association, the Harvard College Fund, and especially our advisors, Leanne Gaffney and Molly Stanzik, for their endless support throughout this year. And perhaps the biggest thank you is to all of you for joining us from far and wide and being here on this special day. Today, Class Day, is a day to look behind us at how much we have grown and learned together over these last 4 years. It's an opportunity to look forward with excitement to all that we may achieve one day. But most importantly, it's a chance to look around us, here and now, and admire the story we share. Though we may come from different backgrounds, study different things, and pursue different hopes and dreams, we did this together. We leaned on each other through hardship and laughed with one another through celebration. And Class Day, today, we sit side by side as distinct individuals who have come together through a shared experience. And together, we can say, we made it. Yes, we did. Class of 2017, today I look around me in complete awe, and I couldn't be more proud to be a part of this community. There are a lot of things that make Harvard special, but it's the people, it's each and every one of you that have made this place home. And to you all, I am grateful. It is now my pleasure to invite to the stage the Danoff Dean of Harvard College, Marvin Bauer, Professor of Leadership Development at Harvard Business School, Professor of Sociology, and Faculty Dean of Cabot House, Dean Rakesh Khurana.
Thank you, Rhea. Thank you, Senior Class Committee, and thank you, Honorable Vice President Joseph Biden, for being here today. We're so excited. This is such one of my favorite days, but I have to admit that the stage feels a little empty today because I know how much Ann Porter of Dunster House loved this day, but I feel her spirit here, and I just want to sort of acknowledge our wonderful colleague, Ann Porter. Good afternoon, seniors! So, tomorrow is a solemn day. You will be taking part of a 366-year-old tradition, which one of my predecessor deans described as follows. Commencement ceremonies are wonderfully ritualistic, full of incantation, and free of explanation. In other words, they're supposed to be self-explanatory, so thank you and good luck. just kidding, let me give you a quick preview. So during the commencement exercises, President Faust will confer the degrees upon the university's graduates. First, the PhD and master's degrees will be called. Then the professional schools will be acknowledged in the reverse order of their founding dates. The deans will then make a brief case for each of their school's graduates. Each school will offer their own cheers, and they'll be waving their symbolic totems in the air. And then, finally, the most important moment in the entire ceremony will occur. The college, as the oldest and original part of this university, will be called forth. And then we will get a chance to top them all. We will remind them of the power of our past and the possibilities of our future. So we're going to make some noise, right? Right? Fantastic. Then when you settle down, I will begin with salutations to President Faust, the Fellows of Harvard Corporation, and the Board of Overseers. After these salutations, I will announce that you have fulfilled the faculty's requirements for the first degree in arts and sciences, which you will have, because it's my responsibility to make sure that it's actually true. And then finally, I will pronounce that, quote, each candidate stands ready to advance knowledge, to promote understanding, and to serve society, end quote. In other words, I will pronounce that you have fulfilled the mission of Harvard College and are ready to go forth to become the citizens and citizen leaders of our society. Your families and loved ones will cheer, and their hearts will be bursting with pride for you. But today, you are still Harvard College students. And tonight, when you sit down for your last dinner as undergraduates, you may find yourself thinking back to your first week in Annenberg, when the friends you are sitting with today were still strangers, and when you may have walked into that great hall with your tray, stared into the sea of unfamiliar faces, and wondered where you might sit and whether there was going to be room for you at the table. These moments of trying to find our place at the table are part of a great human drama that plays out in cafeterias and dining halls everywhere from elementary school to college to workplaces. At these moments, you often find yourself alone, making the social calculations to figure out who will signal to you that you don't belong at their table and who will slide over for you and make room. I have some experience with this myself. Here's a newsflash. When I was in middle school and in high school, I did not have a seat at the cool or beautiful people table. I know, it's surprising. Look at the suit. I knew all of the Lord of the Rings trilogy. But you know the table I'm talking about. The one with the kids that everyone knows, recognizes, and talks about. The kids at this table wear the right clothes, know the latest lingo. Your esteem can hinge on whether they know your name. In middle school, I studied the cool kids. And looking for that type of social validation that seems so important to a 13-year-old, tried to figure out what would get me a place at that table. At that time, I thought it was all about having the right stuff. So heading into high school, I begged my parents to get me the same sneakers the cool kids were wearing. Ironically, Stan Smith's, which seemed to have made a comeback, and a portable music player called the Sony Walkman. Ask your parents, it was like the iPod of our generation. Suffice it to say, it apparently takes more than sneakers and headphones to join the popular kids' table, and there was no signal to me that I was welcome there. I think that's why one of my favorite things to watch over the years in our dining hall is people sliding over and making room for each other. I can think of few other things than this simple act to make someone feel like they're seen, that they belong. When you leave the familiarity of Harvard, you will likely find yourself in situations where you will feel like you're starting over from scratch, and where it won't be clear which table will welcome you. But unlike 4 years ago, when your story was unwritten, you may find that your Harvard degree earns you a seat at any number of tables. And I hope that when you're invited to those tables, you will remember what it was like to stand there in Annenberg or any of our house dining halls, and you will decide that you're going to be the person who slides over and makes room. What I'm talking about here is not just about being friendly or smoothing over awkward social situations. What I'm talking about here is citizenship. Over these past few years, you've heard me remind you that the mission of Harvard College is to educate the citizens and citizen leaders for our society. Today, I am confident that your time here has been educational, and I am so proud of all that you've accomplished. But that second part, becoming a citizen, as James Plitch, our senior, just reminded us in a recent op-ed, is just as important as the educate part. And for that, a lifetime of work remains in front of you. Real citizenship is not so much about privileges, but about how we show up in the world. It's about responsibilities, sacrifices, and fellowship. And that includes which table you choose to sit down at and who you share that table with. Not just in the school cafeteria, but in local government, in the boardroom, in the courtroom, in the classroom, in the operating room, or wherever your lives take you. When you leave here, you may have to make a conscious effort to seek out people who are different from you. And when you lead the table, as many of you may well do, you will need to think about the signals that you're sending about who you're going to invite to that table and why. It will be often most comfortable to connect with your former classmates, teammates, others who went to similar schools, shared similar experiences. In fact, it will not only be comfortable, it will be too easy, because we live in a stratified world where we can live and interact with people who share a way of life, beliefs, life chances, and stereotypes about those who are not at the table. Too often, we like being around people who remind us of our favorite person, ourselves. But as you decide on your path, you may also find that your Harvard degree secures you a seat at some tables that will be easy to join, but maybe not rewarding. And you may want to keep walking to find a table that's not just open to you, but to everyone. Or you may want to sit down and find a way to make that table more open. When my family came to this country as immigrants, we saw the United States as a big table, and people slid over to make room for us. This promise that there is room for everyone at the table is integral to the ideals of America. And now, more than ever, we need to lean into this promise and try to live up to those ideals. I know we will not solve all of society's problems simply by making room at the table. But I also know that we most certainly will not solve our problems if we don't. Change happens one table at a time, one invitation at a time, one citizen at a time. As you look to your futures, I can't wait to see what tables you form and what kind of citizens you become. In the meantime, I want to assure you that when you return to Harvard, there will always be a seat waiting for you at our table. I feel so blessed to have shared this journey with you, and I wish you all my best. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Karana. Thank you, Dean Karana. Listening to you will always be our favorite transformative experience. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Larissa. I'm a proud resident of Elliott House and an honor to have served as your treasurer this year. It's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Susan Morix-Novick. Having graduated with a degree in history and literature, Ms. Novick went on to a distinguished career in entertainment, finance, and journalism, including serving as a writer for the New York Times for over 20 years. She has served on the board of the Harvard Alumni Association since 2007, and as a member of the executive committee since 2014. She's also our incoming president of the Harvard Alumni Association. Please join me welcoming Susan Morix-Novick to the podium.
Thank you, Larissa, and congratulations. Congratulations to all of you in the class of 2017. I'm honored to share this day with you. Tomorrow, you'll receive your diploma, which means, among other things, that you'll never have to fill out a Kew Guide evaluation again. Instead, you'll be joining more than 300,000 Harvard alumni around the world who remember exactly what it feels like to be sitting right where you are today, reflecting on this pivotal moment between college and what comes next. I am one of them. And as a history and literature concentrator from Mather House, a Harvard parent of two, and the incoming president of the Harvard Alumni Association, I can promise you great things are yet to come. When I graduated, way back in the 20th century, when people still wore watches and wrote in longhand, there were so many places at Harvard that I really missed when I left campus. One of my favorite haunts was a secret garden between Holden Chapel and the 1870 gate in the old yard. I often sat there before exams, listening to the silence and admiring the inscription on an old sundial there, which read, "On this moment hangs eternity." That moment became all too real to me in the spring of my junior year. I was taking a Puritan literature course, immersed in the fire and brimstone of Cotton Mather, and the midterm was at noon. I arrived in the garden at 11:30 for some sun and last-minute study. When I felt about a half hour had passed, I looked at my watch. It was still 11:30. I had no idea how long I'd been there, but it certainly felt like eternity. My watch had stopped. I raced to Seaver Hall, pushed through the doors on the second floor, and experienced the nightmare that you've probably all had. There, to my horror, I saw 50 students, heads bowed, scribbling in their blue books. I had missed more than half of the exam. I grabbed the materials, completed and handed in as much as I could, and memorized the last question. Then I walked straight to Lamont, where I answered it in a first-person essay written entirely in Old English, a sort of pilgrim's progress, in which I acknowledged my transgressions, repented, and asked for forgiveness. I ran to the English department and slipped it into the professor's mailbox. Well, lucky for me, Professor Berkovich had a great sense of humor. And I learned a lot about improvisation, crisis management, and creative brainstorming that day, which, as it turns out, came in pretty handy in my later career as a journalist. No matter what your field of study, you have likely learned many lessons like these that transcend the classroom. For instance, you've learned how to turn nouns into verbs, as in thesising and adulting. Some of you, at least a few from Dunster House, have learned how to integrate a dancing moose into your Housing Day video riff of La La Land. You've learned how to eat swai in the dining hall week after week without complaining. And while you may not realize this now, I can assure you and your parents that you have also learned other more important things here too. You have become independent critical thinkers with creative problem-solving skills that will serve you well for the rest of your lives. You've learned how to negotiate and mediate conflict, how to advocate for yourselves, and how to celebrate and respect one another's differences. You've experienced the value of informed and civil debate, the responsibility of leadership, and the patience that social progress often demands. And in an increasingly complex and unpredictable world, you've developed the ability to be adaptive, nimble, and responsive to change when the ground shifts under you or when you choose to be the change maker. When you look back, you may realize that Harvard is where you became who you are, or better realized, who you want to be. In fact, I feel more connected to Harvard now than I did when I was a student, because although Harvard's footprint is here in Cambridge, the Harvard community is global. This year, I look forward to meeting Harvard alumni at HAA conferences in Nicaragua, Portugal, and India. They all share a coming-of-age story that began right here in Harvard Yard, a common values and common interests, before they began to shape their communities and the world. Tomorrow, you and your classmates will be welcomed into this diverse alumni family. So how can you find all of these extraordinary alums? Well, the HAA has been connecting us to one another since John Quincy Adams became its first president in 1840. The technology may have changed since then, but the message has not. So first, join the Facebook groups created by your senior class committee. Register for a global networking night in June. Look for an HAA Welcome to Your City event this fall, when recent grads in more than a dozen cities will be there to show you the ropes in your new hometown. And join the local Harvard Club. There are more than 190 of them around the world. When I was a freshman, I walked through Dexter Gate every day on my way to Wigglesworth and read President Eliot's call to enter and grow in wisdom. Well, I hope you've done that. But my message to you today is that that opportunity continues to be yours wherever you go. So before you walk out of the yard tomorrow for the last time as a Harvard College student, if you happen upon Dexter Gate, look up to read President Eliot's parting words. Depart to serve better thy country and thy kind. If thy kind is all of humanity, you have your work cut out for you. But in this moment, just before you graduate, when everything is possible, take the time to appreciate the people who brought you here, your parents, families, friends, and teachers. They are part of your education too, an education that will pay dividends your whole life long. Stay grateful, stay connected, stay engaged. And now I salute you with the new unofficial motto of the Harvard Alumni Association, Veritas, Ubiquitas, Eternitas. Congratulations, class of 2017, and welcome to the HAA.
Thank you so much, Ms. Novick. Good afternoon. My name is Natalie Torres, and as a class gift marshal, I'm honored to announce the results of our senior gift campaign. In total, 1,009 of us participated in senior gift this year, raising close to $25,000, which was put to work immediately by the college for high priorities like financial aid. On top of that, we garnered $125,000 from challenge donors who were inspired by us and who inspired us to achieve important milestones, including having half of our classmates participate in the first 2 weeks. The class of 2017 senior gift campaign was a success because of you. We hope our gift campaign inspires a tradition of giving back to Harvard. Thank you all so much.
Good afternoon. I'm Jonathan Sands, Senior Class Secretary, and it's my pleasure to introduce Jonathan Roberts, the first of our two Harvard orators. Jonathan is an extraordinary scholar, passionate activist, and beloved mentor to many on our campus. As one of four seniors pursuing a special concentration, Jonathan studies organizational behavior, or how humans behave in organizational settings. Jonathan is also a leader in Harvard's Student Labor Action Movement and Harvard's First Year Urban Program, a pre-orientation program that empowers new students to engage in activism and service throughout Greater Boston. Beyond these achievements, with incomparable wit, Jonathan speaks truth to power and brings humor and joy to his colleagues, friends, and all who know him. Please join me in welcoming him to the stage.
Also, quick shout out to my grandmother who is here with us. She is 93 years old. She's still moving and grooving. Oh my goodness. I hope I get those genes. Now, before I begin, I would like to recognize that we are on the land of the Wampanoag Nation, that this is sacred earth, and that we have a responsibility to care for it and to treat it as such. Now, much to my annoyance growing up, the phrase "back in my day" was used by my parents as often as infamous staples such as "because I told you so" and "I'll give you something to cry about." But as I stand on this stage, childish irritation is replaced by immeasurable gratitude. You see, back in my father's day, students who looked like him, like me, were pushed out of schools like this. Before my mother even turned 16, white families around this country rioted against integration. So these years at Harvard have been a vindication of their struggle and sacrifice, but I have to say this place has a peculiar way of shifting that familial perspective. Now, like many of us, I came here wanting to meet my parents' expectations and become successful, so I internalize what has become a familiar routine. I stressed over problem sets. I worried about internships and jobs. I shook hands. I passed resumes. And soon, personal failures became unbearable. Soon, when I would get rejections from student organizations, I would feel worthless next to my friends. When I would get a bad grade on a test, I would worry about my future. When I would be rejected from jobs and internships, I bemoaned how unfair this world was. I forgot the lessons my parents had spent so many years trying to teach me. So when I was at my lowest and I called out to my dad for help and guidance, and he started the call off by saying, "Back in my day, I hung up." We really do live in an unfair world. Of all the people who could have come here, we are the select few who were chosen. But as we worry about our personal failures here, we will earn and achieve more than families whose only failure was living in a broken, unequal system. And we have been so conditioned by privilege and circumstance that exclusivity is only a crime when we don't receive its spoils. Now, our education here has not prepared us to understand our advantaged position in the world or the authenticity of others' pain. In economics, we learn to quantify and dehumanize suffering. We learn that poverty, inequality, unemployment are unavoidable. That so long as we reach equilibrium, people who live on pennies a day are somehow better off. In social studies and sociology, we learn to treat other suffering as an academic exercise to ponder their pain from a distance. We critique structural inequality and oppression, but how many of us every day for the past 4 years have walked past people in the square experiencing homelessness and acted as though our theories and our conscience did not apply to them? Now, I know we will be successful because we are ambitious and talented and personally driven, and we will become leaders and innovators and founders of businesses and nonprofits. But that is exactly why the change this world so desperately needs will not come from us. That in spite of our jargon, our let's grab a meals, our votes for Hillary, our votes for Joe, we will never sacrifice our position, our place in the system. If we could give up this degree to prevent someone from experiencing homelessness or poverty or discrimination or violence, we wouldn't. And I know this because after 4 years here, I didn't even consider it. But last semester, dining hall workers gave us the education that we so desperately needed. For 3 weeks, they went without pay. They were on picket lines. They marched. They shared their stories and experiences. They sacrificed everything for affordable health care. And still, we were skeptical and indifferent to their pain. One student went so far as to tell me that, unfortunately, in the market we live in, workers without college degrees simply could not be covered. How quickly we have become the political leaders we claim to despise. but dining hall workers remembered the lesson that my parents taught me. They remembered that our struggles are intimately connected. They fought not only for affordable health care, they fought for gender and racial equity, they fought for undocumented workers, they fought for their children, for workers in other universities, for workers around the world, and they won. This is where you clap. Now, as inspired as I am by that show of conviction, I recognize that as we are now, we are not yet ready to inherit this world. It's a hard thing to say, and it's a hard thing to hear. And I am sure it would be easy to leave here feeling guilty, but without any lasting commitment, I'm sure it would be easy to convince ourselves that this is just the way the world works. I am sure, as my parents know all too well, it would be easy for us to justify our privileges and unequal advantages by saying that it's better to take care of our own than to empower individuals who society has disowned. But we have stepped on the blood and bones of people for far too long to forgive ourselves for doing what is easy. No, we need to act beyond ourselves and think about what is possible for others. And I know if I do that, then in the future, when I hear my children complaining about the inconveniences in their world, I will muster the strength to smile. And I will know they are living in a world that is one I could only dream of. Because back in my day,
thank you, Jonathan. Good afternoon. My name is Angela Wu, and the next speaker and I are both proud residents of Pforzheimer House. The two of us met before freshman move-in day as we prepared to embark on a week-long pre-orientation hike in New England. During her time at Harvard, she has been a leader for that very first year outdoor program, co-president of Health Leads, a research fellow at the law school, and has spent summers doing global health work in South Africa and China. More striking than these achievements, perhaps, is her humility despite her brilliance, the time she makes for others despite her accomplishments, and her kindness, which, as many of you already know, is a force, and a Canadian force at that, to be reckoned with. It is my honor to introduce Bessie Zhang to the stage.
Sparks crackled as 10 pairs of hands reached for the fire pit to stay warm. Around the circle sat several bright-eyed incoming freshmen, including myself. We shivered slightly in the evening chill, and I pulled my jacket tighter. Above us, a canopy of stars emerged from the darkness. We were asked to tell a story about ourselves. I had only known these people for 48 hours, but excited, nervous, and willing to go wherever we were pointed, we went ahead. I told the story of my family and our journey settling into North America as immigrants. As I spoke, everyone stayed silent. After I finished, the only sound was the flowing stream and crackling fire. I briefly wondered if I was a terrible storyteller and everyone had fallen asleep. But in this very silence, I felt an inexplicable sense of connection with my peers, who moments ago were strangers. If you had told me that my introduction to Harvard involved body odor built up over 5 days without a shower, I may have gone to Yale. But today, 4 years later, this moment is one of the most formative of my college experience. It wasn't just the warmth of the fire, the scenery it illuminated, or the excitement of starting the next phase of our lives. It was because of the silence. As I spoke, everyone simply listened. Their motivation was not to comment, respond, or refute, but to truly hear what I had to say. Our society values the outspoken, the opinionated. There are debate tournaments, but who's ever heard of a listening tournament? Especially at Harvard, where we are constantly asked to speak our minds and prove ourselves, silence is devalued. But as we focus on talking, we miss an opportunity to grasp the complexity around us. Instead, when we let silence wash over, a space is created for vulnerability and the potential to know others in a way that all our talking could never allow. To hear the person who is brave enough to share in moments of struggle when everyone else seems to have it together. The peer who feels like an outsider. The friend who has secretly endured an experience that has shaped all our interactions. Silence allows us to engage with each other more deeply. It has shown me during my time at Harvard with all of you that the person sitting two rows in front of me has a story as complex, rich, and confusing as my own. In the piece of reflection, we can also engage more genuinely with ourselves. To pause from the programmed noise and rush of the everyday and to just be. Sometimes, instead of books filled with text, we simply need to open one with blank pages onto which our own thoughts, musings, and reflections can pour out. That night, as the flames flickered low, I learned that what made others feel most understood, what made me feel most understood, is an appreciation for the mundane. The stories we find ourselves sharing around the fire are not the contents of our resumes. They are about our families, about a walk we took along the Charles River with a friend, about a call we got from a parent, sibling, or child to check in. It is these hidden moments, the seemingly forgettable substance of our daily lives that make up the very core of who we are. Dear class of 2017, tomorrow we graduate and we leave behind dining hall froyo, historical snow days, and Dean Feaster's fungi. With a Harvard degree come expectations to lead the way, change the world, and assert our presence. But what if we enter the next phase of our lives not only with our talk and opinions, but also our silence? To honor and listen to the complexities around us and in ourselves, whatever they may be. 4 years ago, one of the most powerful welcomes I received at Harvard was in the quiet of nature, as the stream trickled by and the embers continued to glow. We are not gathered around a fire today, but I'd like to practice what I preach and take the last valuable moments of my speech, not speaking with you, but instead, spending the next 10 seconds with you in silence, reflecting and listening to this unique place we have all shared these last 4 years. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Greg Foster. As we look forward to sharing our graduation with friends, families, and mentors, it's important to remember those who are not with us today. 3 years ago, we lost a faithful friend and classmate. To commemorate Haley Rue, we invite on stage her blockmates and friends, Meg Bernard, Jamie Lee Salamano, Peyton Peters, Nina Lowe, and Cindy Okamoto. Please welcome me in joining them.
In Haley's words, I am pretty weird and oftentimes very boldly so. I laugh a lot. I smile always. I don't take everything as seriously as I should, yet I take a few things too seriously. I haven't quite grasped the concept of balance. I really want to find what I'm passionate about, and I have plenty of time.
These are words written by Haley Rue, a good friend to many in our senior class. Haley passed away in the summer of 2014, doing what she loved, traveling and writing as a Europe-based researcher writer for the student guide, Let's Go. We want to spend the next few minutes reading excerpts of her writing and reflecting on the boundless joy she brought to so many of us during our freshman year. Through her hours-long talks in the dining halls, her unwavering support during times of stress and frustration, her spontaneity and willingness to be surprised at whatever life threw her way. We're her blockmates, but we're just five of the hundreds of people Haley touched and changed while she was here at Harvard. Haley found the beauty in everything, from the snow-capped mountains in her hometown of Tacoma, Washington, to the constant buzz of life in Annenberg during lunchtime. As the valedictorian of her high school class, a nationally ranked speaker, and an avid basketball player, Haley was accomplished. But what made her so unique was her capacity for love. She maintained a blog chronicling her life at Harvard. The following excerpt comes from her About Me page. I sat across from my Harvard interviewer at a Starbucks during the winter morning of my senior year and told him that if I could do anything with my life, money not being an object, I would be a nomad. I would not cure anything, discover anything, win anything. I would travel and write.
After she was first accepted into Harvard, Haley reflected on what she wanted her time here to be like. Am I really good enough for Harvard? Everyone is going to question themselves at some point. It's our nature. But instead of succumbing to this doubt, we need to use it as a stepping stone to better ourselves. Just like I need to stop worrying about how I'll compare to my future classmates and start studying Spanish more and math. And mainly, I need to realize that I got into Harvard for a reason. I'm going there with a mission. So my mindset at this exact moment, a little over 24 hours after completing that mind-numbing placement exam, is of determination to seize every opportunity presented to me in the next 4 years. I must not be intimidated or afraid to use my voice.
Before flying out to Budapest to start her summer travels, Haley spent a few weeks in Cambridge reflecting upon her freshman year. Being here now is not only refreshing, but relieving, because it feels like I'm where I belong. At many points this past year, I wanted to run as far away as possible from its ivy-clad brick. But now that everything is quiet, I have time to take it all in and reflect. And I'm realizing once more how incredible it is to be here. Although my ongoing tangle with stress and insanity at times made me question how much I like college, the truth is, college is incredible, and Harvard is home.
After completing her freshman year at Harvard, Haley witnessed the commencement of the class of 2014 and envisioned her own graduation. I tried to imagine how I will feel when I'm sitting next to some of the most brilliant 1600 young adults in the world. Ready to engage with that very world. I can't put it into words other than exciting. It's so exciting to think of where we all might end up. I'm so excited about the future.
Good afternoon. My name is Liv Novick.
My name is Yesenia Jimenez.
Today it is our honor to introduce the recipients of the Richard Glover and Henry Russell Ames Memorial Award. As many of you already know, the members of the class of 2017 have shown a great commitment to the service of others over the past 4 years. In particular, the Ames Award honors two unsung heroes of the class of 2017.
On June 19, 1935, Richard Glover Ames and Henry Russell Ames, brothers and Harvard students, gave their lives to save their father, who was washed overboard during a storm off the coast of Newfoundland. Every year since, the Ames Award has been given in their memory to recognize two members of the class who have shown energy in helping others and who exhibit the same heroic character and leadership of the Ames brothers. The selection committee received a large number of nominations from faculty, faculty deans, tutors, coaches, and former and current students. We invite all of the nominees of this year's Ames Award to please stand or raise your hand and be recognized for your commitment to service and leadership. Please join us in congratulating all of the nominees.
At this time, it is my pleasure to introduce the first recipient of the Ames Award. This graduating senior has dedicated hundreds of hours to serving others and has touched the lives of many students through her thoughtfulness, interest in getting to know others deeply, and contagious joy for life. Many know her by her smile and her love for her home state of Vermont, yet few are aware of the extent to which she has served the homeless population in Harvard Square. She joined the youth-to-youth homeless shelter, known as Y2Y, her freshman year, serving as staff director. Started at Harvard, Y2Y is the nation's first student-run youth homeless shelter and houses more than 20 people an evening. This student has fully dedicated herself to the organization, working long shifts in the shelter, serving as the emotional backbone for other staff members during times of difficulty, and even spending the majority of her winter breaks and Christmas days at the shelter for the past 2 years. While many seniors choose to wind down their involvement in student organizations during their final months at school, this semester she has worked with a team to pioneer Y2Y Summer Shelter, a soon-to-be reality in the coming months. As one friend who nominated this student described, there are many students here at Harvard with passions. There are few, however, whose passions are wholly selfless. Please join me in congratulating our first Ames Award recipient, Jennifer Howe.
It is my honor to introduce the second recipient of this year's Ames Award. In the words of one of his nominators, our second Ames recipient is a graduating senior who valiantly leads from and for the margins of America. In spite of and because of the significant adversity that the most marginalized face in this nation today. With enduring courage and strong leadership, this individual has spent much of his time at Harvard tirelessly advocating for the institutional support for ethnic studies, the latest iteration of a campaign of student activism that has lasted over 40 years. As a result of his efforts, the college has created a track for ethnic studies within the history and literature concentration, paving the way for future investment in this field and a landmark achievement in the history of this movement. Students will finally be able to study race, ethnicity, indigeneity, and other marginalized identities with a focus on the perspective of people of color that are often neglected in academia. Through this individual's work and commitment, he has inspired underclassmen to serve and advocate for others on this campus and beyond. Countless younger and future Harvard students will benefit from his hard work and impressive leadership. Please join me in congratulating our second Ames Award recipient, Juwan So.
Ladies and gentlemen, and my close personal friend, Joseph Biden. My name is Rohan Pittaparty, and I have the unique pleasure of introducing our first Ivy orator, my friend Declan Garvey. Give it up for Declan. Declan is a history concentrator living in Mather House, the outgoing president of the Harvard Republican Club, and an excellent peer advising fellow. Today, Declan will be reflecting on his experience here at Harvard, and I must warn you, his speech does contain prolific use of the F word. That's right, Declan will be discussing failure at Harvard. Without further ado, please join me in a big round of applause for Declan.
Thank you, Rohan. Yeah? My fellow graduates, proud parents, and younger siblings still harboring some slight resentment over the unrealistic expectations that we set for you. Welcome to Harvard's Class Day 2017. To quote the Honorable Vice President Joe Biden, seated behind me here today, this is a big effing deal. Thank you. I'm here this afternoon to talk to you about failure and success, the ceaseless prism through which we all view our lives, and increasingly over the past year, the method in which my classes have been graded. But Declan, you may be wondering, how can you possibly talk to us about failure? You're so talented and handsome. And to that, I would say to you, please sit down, Mom. You're interrupting my big speech. We talked about this. Seriously, though, I failed a lot on this campus, and so have all of you. Except for my good friend Daniel. He's PBK, and his diploma tomorrow is going to have the word summa, or mine will just say, so meh. That was my big Latin pronunciation joke. We failed to take our first final exams without being interrupted by bomb threats, and we failed to avoid throwing up in the elevator at freshman formal so much that Harvard is not allowed to hold events there anymore. I, myself, even failed a statistics midterm once. Actually, fail probably is not the right word there. I got an 11%. But thanks to Harvard's grade inflation, I still ended up with an A. I got a C+, but my friends here today would not believe this, but in high school, my parents actually begged me to get a B so that I could experience a setback and learn to cope with imperfection. Mom, Dad, these past 4 years were for you. My second biggest failure, besides that Stat 110 hiccup, was letting Donald Trump become president. Sorry about that. I should explain. Last fall, I held undoubtedly the most impressive and influential political position of anybody on this stage today. I was president of the Harvard Republican Club. Hold your applause, please. Thank you. I will say, though, as a history major, we've left the office of the vice presidency vacant a combined 38 years since our nation's founding. Harvard Republican Club presidency, never unoccupied. Which one's more important? I don't know. I'm not a conspiracy theory guy, but I am a connect the dots guy. But speaking of conspiracy theory guys, Donald Trump. During the campaign, I wrote an op-ed, some tweets, and several strongly worded Facebook statuses saying maybe, just maybe, he wouldn't be the best president. Now, luckily, I was way off base. He's doing so well, so well. But at the time, that was an incredibly brave thing for me to do. Our president is very, very popular amongst the student body here. But even after I really stuck my head out amongst my peers, Donald Trump is, at this very moment, probably divulging classified information to the Russians. But enough about me. Let's focus on our failures. Many of us failed to make it through the ominous Harvard comp process. We didn't write well enough for The Advocate. We didn't sing well enough for The Crocs. We weren't attractive enough for Crimson Key. Much to Dean Carana's delight, most of us failed to get into exclusive single-gender social organizations. And much to Dean Carana's chagrin, Harvard's most dynamic social space is now a meme page on Facebook. We failed to totally grab a meal sometime. We failed to really get outside the Harvard bubble more. We failed to show up for intramurals, yes, Winthrop, except for you. Yeah. And we failed off to fend failed to fend off the freshman 15, or in my case, the freshman 35. I will miss you dearly, HUD's salted caramel cake. When you say it out loud, we sure did fail a lot, and I haven't even touched my dating life yet. But yet here we are, about to graduate from the number one university on the planet. Shut up, Princeton. U.S. World Report is fake news. So maybe failure, a concept as unnerving to Harvard students as mumps, or more recently, tuberculosis, is actually not so bad. In fact, failing that stats midterm led to my much more successful tenure as a history concentrator. Not that much more successful. Failing to get into The Advocate or Crimson Key allowed me to discover my passion for public service at the Institute of Politics or as a peer advising fellow in Hollis North. Failing to join a final club led to me meeting friends that will last a lifetime. To quote one of my favorite movies, the PBS Kids classic, Arthur's Perfect Christmas, you don't always get what you want in life. Sometimes you get something better. As we wrap up our turn here in this hallowed yard and walk out of Johnston Gate for the very last time, most of us have a unique and exhilarating path before us. And the rest of us are working for Goldman Sachs. Let us not be afraid to deviate from the standard measures of success that have so often come to define our time here. Beyond these walls, the clothes that you wore, the likes that your profile picture garnered, the grades that you received hold little weight. So please, do not be afraid to fail. Because apparently, even a kid who just last week burned himself doing laundry and once ripped his jeans taking a nap can stand before you this afternoon and speak to the class day for the Harvard College class of 2017. Congratulations to everyone seated here today. I can't wait to witness all of your failures and the successes that they lead to. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Cecilia LaGuarda, and I am thrilled to be here today to introduce our second Ivy orator, my friend and linkmate, Rachel Stromberg. Rachel is a senior from Quincy House, and at Harvard, she has been a writer at the Lampoon, and she wrote for many shows on campus, including Sketch, a comedy show, the Freshman Musical, and an Arts First performance starring Dean Dingman and Dean Karana. Please join me in welcoming Rachel.
Classmates, friends, enemies, parents, faculty, and uncomfortable Tinder dates in way over your heads, welcome to class day. I want to thank Joe Biden for being here today and taking this time out of his busy schedule starring in internet memes. I'm thrilled to be here today, and I hope that this speech will be the most touching, hilarious 3 hours of your week. But if at any point you don't like one of my jokes, please do feel free to write me a long, strongly worded letter of complaint. These can be sent to me via email at david.malin@harvard.edu. Now, I'm sure many of you are wondering, who even is this tall, gawky nerd on the stage right now? Well, that is Dean Thomas Dingman, and I would thank you to be a little more polite to him. What has that man ever done to you? Class of 2017, we are about to graduate from Harvard. We are all about to embark into a new and exciting phase of our lives. But to be honest, when I reviewed my admissions file recently, when I reread my application essay, thought back on my high school self, and saw the words pity admit stamped on my file in bold red letters, I couldn't help but wonder, are we really ready? Has Harvard taught us enough? Isn't it kind of messed up that they have a stamp for that? Well, I don't have the answers to those questions. And frankly, the senior class committee isn't paying me $5,000 to stand up here theorizing about it. No, the reason I'm standing up here today is to tell you one very important thing. You see, over the past 4 years, I have kept track of every single song the Lowell Bellringers have played. And hidden within the song titles, I have uncovered a secret coded message. If you take the sixth letter of every fourth song played on even-numbered Sundays and read them backwards, you get this message. Please help. My adoptive father, Judge Claude Frollo, has imprisoned me in this bell tower and forbidden me from venturing out into the city of Paris. Now, I don't know what this message could mean, but I know one thing. I wasted a lot of time figuring it out. I mean, that was time I could have spent doing readings for class, or hanging out with my friends, or studying at Widener. In fact, the more I thought about it, the more I began to fear that I may have wasted a lot of my time here at Harvard. I felt an overwhelming sense of sadness, like a CS concentrator reading the honor code, or a VES concentrator being asked about their plans after graduation, or an applied math concentrator. Topical. I asked myself, where have the last 4 years gone? So I decided to figure it out, using something dark from my past that I'd hoped to leave behind forever, math. Now, according to my calculations, over the past 4 years, I spent a total of 12,500 hours sleeping. Okay. For the math savants shaking your heads in the audience, I didn't make a mistake. 14 hours a day is correct. I spent 2,000 hours on the internet, 500 hours sitting in lecture. So scratch that, 2,500 hours on the internet, 400 hours at the Mac before I was unfortunately banned for being too fit, 7 hours walking to and from the quad. That's right, I went there twice. Okay, easy joke, I know. Again, david.malin@harvard.edu. After I'd finished doing the math, I took a deep breath. Now I knew, down to the hour, where the last 4 years had gone. And honestly, I found that I wouldn't have wanted to change any of it. Except maybe those 4 hours I spent trying to get Martin Shkreli to text me back. That turned out to be a total bust. But I realized that I didn't waste my time here at all. It only feels like that now because it's over and I'm gonna miss it. I chose to dedicate my time to uncovering a vast conspiracy hidden in the chimes of those infernal bells. Maybe you spent yours working in a lab or performing in one of Harvard's many wonderful theater groups or in the Hasty Pudding. Don't worry, I'm not offending them. They couldn't care less what I have to say. Regardless, it's the choices you've made about how to use your time here at Harvard that's given the last 4 years meaning and made you who you are today. Jobless narcissists, mostly. Class of 2017, if I could give you one piece of advice, and I can, because at this point, the only way I can be stopped is if Rakesh Khurana gets up and tackles me to the ground. It would be this. Don't torture yourself for not making the most of your time at Harvard. It's impossible. It's a myth, an enticing lie, like individualized advising or Visitas. No one can go to every talk, see every show, read every scouting report. There are just far, far too many. So if the last 4 years feel like they've gone by faster than you could have imagined, well, that's a good thing. After all, you know what they say? Time flies when you're having transformative experiences. Thank you. Congrats, class of 2017.
Good afternoon. My name is Avni Nahar.
And I am Victoria Jones. It is our incredible honor to introduce the 2017 Class Day Speaker, Vice President Joe Biden.
As Susan Novick mentioned, Dexter Gate, sitting just behind Widener Library and leading into Harvard Square, bears a call to action that has meant a lot to many of the members of the senior class over our 4 years at the college. Depart to better serve thy country and thy kind. There are few individuals who exemplify this message better than Vice President Biden.
In a career that has spanned almost 50 years, the Vice President has served as a public defender, a county councilman, a U.S. senator, and of course, as our Vice President for 2 terms. And he isn't stopping now, as he recently launched the Penn Biden Center for Diplomacy and Global Engagement at the University of Pennsylvania, and worked with his wife, Dr. Jill Biden, to establish the Biden Foundation, which seeks to find a cure for cancer one day.
He has been the recipient of innumerable honors and awards, most recently including the Presidential Medal of Freedom, awarded with distinction, a recognition that has only been bestowed on 3 other individuals. Yet, while an impressive resume is important, a fact all of us who applied for jobs this year know all too well, what made Victoria and I most excited to bring the Vice President to campus was not his career highlights, but instead his outstanding and inspirational character.
Throughout our formative years of high school and time at Harvard, we watched you lead the country with dignity, perseverance, and immense diplomacy. You have shown us integrity and compassion. You have remained optimistic through even the most challenging of times, and you have refreshed us with your humor and personality, such as a friendly wink at the State of the Union address or sharing your love for ice cream. You have shown us what it means to be a great public servant and leader, as well as a great father, husband, and friend.
Our class is very grateful to hear from a leader today who embodies the spirit of service so genuinely and who has greatly influenced the way we think about the United States, the wider world, and each of our places within it. Please join us in welcoming Vice President Joseph Biden to the stage.
Thank you very much. What a lovely and undeserved introduction. Thank you. Really, thank you very much. Well, class marshals, senior class committee, Dean Karana, family members, class of 2017. Rachel, what the hell is this about $5,000? You didn't tell me anything about it in 5 minutes. Rachel told me she read when I filed my financial disclosure as vice president. Unfortunately, this is true. The headline in the Washington Post was, "It's probable no man has ever assumed the office of vice president with fewer assets than Joe Biden." Well, and Declan, I want to make it clear to you, I still have Secret Service and they're armed. And President Trump, I didn't say those things about you today. Declan, You got a future, kid. I mean, this is, I hope you stay engaged, old buddy. I really do. I genuinely do. And I want you all to know that when that comment was picked up of my saying this is a big deal, thank God my mother was alive. And I want you to know, and the official press can tell you, I didn't, no one heard that said. One of your colleagues read my lips as I was speaking to. Not a joke. So I just want you all to be aware, Declan, in your career, they can read lips too, okay? And Governor Cuomo, my good friend, is here, and to carry. Today's a good day, Gov. You get a pay raise. That means that you don't have to pay tuition next year. All you parents, celebrate. Okay, right up front, I want to show a hands. How many of you here are just hoping to create one last Facebook post for the Harvard memes, a page before graduation? I mean, me and the dean in one place. It's time to break the internet. You know what I mean? There's hope.
You got your glasses? I didn't bring glasses, but I got my meme page.
All right. All right. Now look, I know a lot of you are counting the minutes until you can ditch your parents and head to the Kong, but this day's for them too, you know. It's not just yours, and the Scorpion Bowl can wait. I want you all to know that I want you to take a minute right now, and I mean this sincerely, to thank your parents for putting up with 4 years of standing there when someone comes up to you and they're with you and they say, where do you go to school? And you reply, near Boston. They paid a hell of a lot of money for you to say Harvard. We know you meant Harvard. We cracked the code. You know, there's nothing to be ashamed of. My son from Penn and Yale said that. There's nothing to be ashamed of that. You can laugh, son of a gun. I mean, it's all right. Look, I'm honored to be here today as your class speaker. When I got the invitation, my two nieces, Alana Biden, who graduated from here with honors, and my other niece, Casey Owens, who was a great lacrosse player here as well, they thought it was a great idea that I'd come and accept it. My son went to Yale Law School. He didn't think it was such a big deal. But my son at Penn, he didn't think either Harvard, Yale or Harvard were such a big deal. But when I've told my son, and I mean this sincerely, that the class invited me, the class committee, everybody, including me, thought it was a great honor. And I am truly honored. I'm honored to be here. And I bet when you find out when Zuckerberg was going to be your commencement speaker, you figured out you needed someone who was more in tune with your generation to speak. And so I understand. I understand why I was chosen. You know, I know Mark. Mark and I have a lot of things in common. Neither one of us have a Harvard degree. And together, we're worth approximately $62 billion. So what the hell? I mean, you know. Oh, man. I'm not even going to talk about Russia. Anyway. Look, class of 17, congratulations. You made it, and you made it through Ec 10. You made it through Gov 20. You made it through CS 50, or whichever class kept you holed up in the library for days on end. Speaking of which, has anyone aired out Lamont after finals week? It's a lot of tension here. You made it through 4 years of Boston winners just in 2015. And you finally made it through the gnawing suspicion that your letter of acceptance must have been a mistake to realize that you really do belong here. Unfortunately, now for the rest of your life, you're going to have to deal with the fact that every time you make some remotely stupid comment, someone's going to pipe up and say, "Great job, Harvard." But it's a cross I think you can bear. Class of 17, you're graduating in a world of incredible change, where an awful lot of people are anxious and uncertain about their futures. I know you know this feeling as well. Your Harvard tenure has been marked by upheaval. Even before you arrived on campus, you learned that your visitas weekend was canceled because of the Boston Marathon bombing. I'm sure that caused some anxiety for both you and your parents. But then you saw how this great city responded, how the people of Boston showed that America never gives up, never gives in, never bends, never ever bows, and we own the finish line. That's what Boston showed us all. And then this past election cycle churned up some of the ugly realities that still remain in our country. Civilized discourse and real debate gave way so many times to the coarsest of rhetoric, stoking the darkest emotions. I thought we had passed the days when it was acceptable for politicians at all levels to bestow legitimacy on hate speech or fringe ideologies. But the world is changing so rapidly that there are an awful lot of folks out there, not just here in the United States, but around the world, who are both afraid of the change and susceptible to this kind of negative appeal. Globalization has cost some of them their livelihoods. Digitalization, Moore's Law, artificial intelligence are generating great anxiety in so many sectors of this country and the world. Some communities are literally struggling to get by, and they're worried. They're worried that they won't be able to keep up with this rapidity of the change they're seeing. And so we saw, not for the first time in our history, but we saw how when you play on the fears, appeal to baser instincts rather than our better angels, you can still reap some temporary but powerful political success. We saw the forces of populism here and abroad seek to close our nation's gate against the challenges of a rapidly changing world, to blame our troubles on the other, the outsider, the immigrant, the minority, the transgender, anyone not like me became a scapegoat. Just build a wall. Keep Muslims from coming to our country. They're the reason I'm falling behind, why I can't compete, why I lost my job, why I worry about my safety. And I imagine for many of you, seeing this unfold was incredibly disorienting and disheartening, as it was for so many Americans all across the country. Your reaction is understandable, but I guarantee you, I assure you, this condition is temporary. It's a temporary state of affairs. The American people will not sustain this attitude. To state the obvious, no graduating class gets to choose the world into which they enter. History has already been written for you by those of us who came before you. But you're graduating in a moment of change and upheaval, both here and abroad. As one of my favorite poets, Yeats, wrote on Easter Sunday, 1916, he wrote the words, "All changed, changed utterly, a terrible beauty is born." I think that line more applies to the world today than it did Yeats's Ireland 100 years ago. All has changed, changed utterly. But it's up to you, the generation of this graduating class, to determine where such utter change will lead us. You have a chance to actually help bend the arc of history closer to where you want as a nation. You heard that phrase all the time, you can bend the arc. It only occurs. The opportunity only occurs in moments of great change. And you must look at it as an opportunity. And sometimes perspective can be helpful. I remember, like your parents do, sitting where you are. For me, it was June of 1968. As we began our last semester, we thought the war in Vietnam was going to be over in a matter of months. But then, the start of that semester, the Viet Cong launched the Tet Offensive in an effort to end the war in one single seismic assault. 2 days into that offensive, a bullet fired on the streets of Saigon by a Vietnam police chief went through the skull of a handcuffed Viet Cong soldier, as a photograph captured that mayhem. Although it was years ago, you probably all saw that iconic photo. That one bullet not only pierced that soldier's skull, but it pierced America's consciousness as well. It brought home to everyone of my generation that there really was no end in sight. There was no light at the end of the tunnel. Lenny Bruce, a comedian at the time, said, "There's a light at the end of the tunnel, and it's a freight train." And that's how we felt. Peaceful anti-war demonstrations turned violent all across America. And the violence exploded in Vietnam as well. That year alone, we lost 17,000 of my generation. That year alone died in Vietnam. 1968 was the first year Harvard students instituted this class day tradition. Your invitee was Dr. Martin Luther King, one of my heroes. That's how I got engaged in the civil rights movement in my segregated state, sitting in, protesting. He was assassinated the month before he was scheduled to speak here. A major political leader, an American icon, our moral compass, gunned down on the balcony in Memphis. Cities, including my hometown of Wilmington, Delaware, went up in flames. My city was the only city in the history of the United States of America since Reconstruction to be occupied by the National Guard for 9 months with drawn bayonets standing on every corner as I returned home to practice law. Then as I walked across the stage to receive my diploma, my only political hero, Kara's grandfather, Kerry's dad, Bobby Kennedy, was assassinated in a cafeteria. Not a cafeteria, a kitchen. After winning the nomination, in a de facto winning the nomination in California. I remember looking around, I remember all of our classmates talking. We thought, how can this be happening? Name me a 5 month period short of war that's been as climactic as that. But you know what? In spite of everything, most of us, I never doubted for one instant that we could change history. And I come from a technically lower class, middle class household, educated by two high school educated parents. Convinced me there wasn't a damn thing I couldn't do and this country couldn't do. That my generation, I was convinced, could rewrite the outcome we were careening toward. We knew that just because they murdered our heroes did not mean the dream did not live still buried deep in our broken hearts. We got involved. We turned our anger and our disappointment into resolve. And I would respectfully argue over the next 10 years, positive change. Just 4 years after I walked off the stage like you are, as a kid with no money, knowing no one, I ran for the United States Senate in my state. Richard Nixon won my state by 68% of the vote. But I was determined to end the war in Vietnam or play my part. Not long after that, after being elected, I sat in a cabinet room across from a very decent man, Gerald Ford, President Ford. The seat I sat in for 8 years as vice president, this chair that now is in my home, looking at Dr. Henry Kissinger and Secretary of Defense Jim Schlesinger, with my senior colleagues in the Foreign Relations Committee, the next youngest person was 30 years older than me. For months, the administration had been saying that they had a plan to end the war in Vietnam. You get to ask questions based on seniority. Everybody was very polite with the president, asking generically about what the plan was. It came my turn to ask my question. I looked at President Ford, determined, but trying to be as polite as I could, and I remember saying, Mr. President, I'm sure if the president were in my position, the president would ask the president the following question. Mr. President, you haven't told us any plan. That was the first time on record President Ford turned to Kissinger and said, tell them the plan in Sector 3. My colleagues thought it was inappropriate, my being so bold. But less than a few months later, the last personnel were being lifted off the Saigon embassy roof, and the war was over. And not long after that, Kerry, I was assigned to your father's office, Senator Robert Kennedy's office. That was 1968. This is 2017. And of one thing I am absolutely certain, this graduating class, this generation, is fully, completely capable of changing the trajectory of this country as well today. You're better equipped to tackle the challenges that lie ahead than my generation was. You're the best educated, most talented, most engaged generation this country has ever, ever produced. That is not hyperbole. That is a fact. And you have tools available to you that we didn't possess. There's more power in that iPhone the dean pulled out than the computers that sent the man to the moon. 3D printers are restoring tissue after traumatic injuries. Scientists here and all across America are working on how to, with 3D printers, produce human organs that are capable of transplant. Software translates real-time conversations into multiple languages. Technology is there to fight climate change. We will cure cancer. Before you're sitting here with your children, you will be flying around the world at 22,000 miles an hour subsonically. You'll be able to get in a plane here and be in Hong Kong. In no time. There's nothing beyond our capacity. There's nothing you're incapable of overcoming. If we remember who we are as Americans, and I'm not talking politics, Democrat, Republican, just who we are, what we've always striven to be. We're a nation grounded on a notion that everyone is entitled to be treated with dignity. Everyone. Cut through it all. That's what it's about. According dignity to everyone. We're a nation that has always thought big, not small. I'm so tired of both political parties talking about incrementalism. America has always thought big and boldly. What has happened to us? And we're a nation. From our founding, we've been a nation of optimists. But in order to fill your destiny, class of 17, it's absolutely essential for you to engage in the world around you. Engage, just like you did here on Harvard's campus, and I learned about you lying down in front of Memorial Chapel to insist that Black Lives Matter, or seeing Harvard University dining service workers through their strike, standing with them in a fight for better health care, or joining the hundreds of thousands who came together to take part in a women's march, or the science march, or the climate march. You've got to, you must maintain that determination and commitment to making things better once you leave this campus, because as I said, you're the most engaged, tolerant, talented generation in our history. But none of that will matter if you don't get engaged in the public affairs of this nation. Harvard's own Institute of Politics, my sister taught, recently put out a study that said, even though your generation is more aware of the tangible impact politics can have on your life, fewer of you are interested in getting involved in public service. Only 9% of your generation, that's all. And if you break it down by gender, it's even worse. Only 7% of women say they're thinking about a life in the public sector. And just this week, the Crimson reported that 37% of your class who had been considering a job in the federal government changed your mind in the wake of last year's election. Forgive me, but I think that's the wrong reaction. You have an obligation to get engaged. You have the capacity to make things change. It's within your wheelhouse to do it. And folks, please, for God's sake, because I, by the way, I know how, you know, the image of people who see Harvard from a distance around the country think of you all as wealthy children of SciComm families. A lot of you work like hell to get here. A lot of you are here only because the school made up the difference between the tuition and what you can afford. A lot of you are here because you work so hard to get here. You deserve to be here. So don't fool yourself into thinking, now that you have this prestigious degree, and it is a prestigious degree, it will open doors for you that could not be opened otherwise. I watched my son, Beau, who graduated from Penn. He decided out of loyalty to go to Syracuse Law School because his father did. He could have gone other places. He did well. He ended up becoming the attorney, one of the youngest attorney generals in the state's history. He was a decorated war hero. He won the Bronze Star. As a civilian, he volunteered to go to Kosovo for a year in the middle of the war to set up their criminal justice system. As a major, he was in a battle theater for a year in Iraq. Bright kid, who I just lost, but a great kid. He graduated with great grades. His brother, a year behind him, graduated from Yale Law School. Not a kid in his class got a job offer less than 150 grand, more than federal judges were making. Not a joke. While my capable son graduated from Syracuse, that class had trouble getting jobs. You've earned, like my son Hunter at Yale earned, you've earned the right. But don't kid yourself. It will open doors for you that can't be opened by the vast majority of seniors graduating. But with that comes an obligation. And don't fool yourself into thinking that disengaging from the system that you think is broken will hold you harmless from the system's failures. You can't cut yourself off from the consequences of a failed political system, Goldman Sachs or not. You can't erect a bubble around you and your family. What happens in your country and your community is going to affect you. If our nation is permanently riddled with this much income inequality, if we're unable to create good-paying middle-class jobs in the age of artificial intelligence and automation, you'll not be able to thrive economically. If your sister is the victim of domestic violence, you are violated. If your brother can't marry the man he loves, you are lessened. If your best friend has to worry about being racially profiled, you live in a circumstance not worthy of this country. And if the global rules that underwrite our security, if the liberal state breaks down, we'll all be less safe and less free. If the air we breathe is not clean, the water not pure, there is nowhere, no matter how well successful you are, for you to hide. There's no wall high enough. There's no gated community that can insulate you from your own failure to engage. Whichever path you take away from these ivied halls, however you choose to engage or get involved, one thing is certain. Each of you is going to have to navigate the traps and temptations that lie ahead as you enter the real world. A little bit like what you talked about, Dean. There's an incredible amount of pressure in your generation to succeed. You might notice that you start slipping into a bubble that validates certain choices, that prioritizes the social trappings of success rather than really making a difference. Take this job. Live in this place. Hang out with people just like you. Take no real risks and have no real impact. Don't just accept what others view as the right choice for you. Instead, choose what you feel is the right choice, based on what's important to you. My dad used to have an expression, Joey, it's a lucky person wakes up in the morning, puts both feet on the floor, knows what they're about to do, and thinks it still matters. I'll bet if you look around this convocation, there's a lot of very successful people here. If they told you the truth, they wonder whether what they do still matters. There's no silver bullet, no reductive list for you to follow as you go into the world. A good life filled with purpose results from accumulation of 1,000 little things. I've met hundreds of successful people in the course of my career. I've met every major world leader in the last 42 years because of the nature of my job. And I've made some basic observations about those who manage to find success and happiness, those who find purpose and fulfillment. I mean this sincerely. First, those who find success and happiness understand that a good life is about being personal. It's about being engaged. It's about being there for a friend or a colleague when they're injured in an accident. It's about little things like remembering to congratulate them on a marriage or the birth of a child or graduation. It's about being available as they're going through some serious personal loss or failure. It's about being personal. Resist the temptation to let network be a verb that saps the personal away, that blinds you to the person right in front of you, their hopes, their fears, their burdens. Resist the temptation to ascribe motive to someone's actions because you really don't know their motive. And it only gets in the way of ever reaching a consensus or making progress. Build real relations, even with people with whom you vehemently disagree. You'll not only be happier, I guarantee you, you'll be more successful. The second thing is remember that although no one is better than you, everyone's your equal and deserves to be treated with dignity and respect. I've worked with 8 presidents, hundreds of senators, met most leaders, as I said, had scores of talented people from every great institution in this country and abroad work for me. And here's what I observed. Regardless of their academic or social backgrounds, those who had the most success and were most respected, and therefore got the most done, were the ones who never confused academic credentials or social sophistication with gravitas or judgment. You and your parents know some really brilliant people who are really stupid. No, I'm serious. I'm being deadly earnest. And don't forget the things that don't come with this degree. What doesn't come with this degree is the heart to distinguish between what's meaningful and what's fleeting, and the head to know the difference between knowledge and judgment. Remember the neighborhood you came from. Remember those who didn't have the same chance you had or the same ability you had. Their instincts, their dignity. Remember, they are still capable of doing extraordinary things as well, if given half a chance. And finally, never forget that reality has a way of intruding. Tomorrow you'll receive this incredibly prestigious degree. And as I said, you earned it, you deserve it, and all that goes with it. And I have no doubt that each of you is going to be very, very successful. And personal ambition is important. It's an incredible motivator. No one has ever accused me of being unambitious. But ambition without perspective is a killer when reality intrudes. And it will intrude. As I said, I got elected when I was 29 years old, the second youngest man in the history of the United States of America ever to be popularly elected. I was on top of the world. I was hiring my staff in Washington, D.C. on December 18th. And I got a call from a young person from the fire department they put on the phone. She didn't know what to say. She just said, "Mr. Biden, your wife and daughter are dead. And your 2 sons may not live. A tractor trailer broadsided them. Come home." Reality intrudes. But because I had an incredibly good fortune of an extended family, grounded in love and loyalty and a sense of obligation they imparted to me, I not only got help by focusing on my sons, they were my redemption. I began commuting every single day, and I did it for 37 years, 259 miles a day from Washington to Wilmington, Wilmington to Washington. No, it's not about me. Thank you. You're very, very generous, but not about me. I needed to be. I needed them. Because I learned what all your parents know. A child can hold an important thought for his mother or father 12, maybe 24 hours. But if you miss it, it's gone. It's gone. And so that's why I went home every night and lay in bed with them and got up in the morning with them. No Ozzie and Harry at breakfast or anything like that, but just a chance to talk. You're going to face your own crisis. Your parents have faced worse crises. Many of you have already faced worse crises. The truth is, you all go through something difficult. You'll wrestle with the kinds of choices every day. And as you do, it helps a great deal if you resist the temptation to rationalize. I know it's her birthday, but it really doesn't matter that much to her. And this business opportunity is so important. It will mean so much to all of us if I just leave and make that appointment. I know this may be his last game, but in order to make it, I'll have to take the red eye back, and then I got to get in the morning and fly the next day back again. He'll understand. Or I know we've been planning this vacation to the family for a long time. But there'll be other times because there's just too much of an opportunity for me here. It matters. It matters. It's possible to be both happy and successful. And it's possible to find balance between ambition and your family. But you have to resist the temptation to rationalize. I'm so very optimistic about your generation. I know you're going to rise to meet these challenges with the same irrepressible, irreducible American spirit that's long defined this country and the people have walked off this campus. We're still grappling with the deep-rooted cankers of injustice and inequity that have always challenged our quest for more perfect union. And we're also facing new challenges that are going to require your generation to break new ground. Climate change, cyber rules, norms, threat of pandemic diseases. Each generation is asked to earn anew the mantle of leadership of our nation, to define our place in the world. Class of 17, you're stepping into the generation where it's now your turn. And make no mistake about it, the United States is so much better positioned than any country in the world to lead the world. I want the class, if they think of nothing that I've said but this. Ladies and gentlemen, I am so sick and tired of this attitude as woe is me. We have such enormous problems. Ladies and gentlemen, we're better positioned than any nation in the world. I've not met a single world leader who wouldn't trade places and problems with us in a heartbeat. I've spent more time with President Xi than any world leader has. 25 hours of private dinners with him. They not only don't have energy, they don't have enough water. Water. 30% of their arable land is polluted with cadmium. They got to find 9,500,000 urban jobs a year. I want them to succeed. But the idea China is going to eat our lunch? Give me a break. In the late 90s, I debated the Heritage Foundation at the Wharton School when Japan was going to own America. Come on, for God's sake. No. They're good countries. We want them to succeed. But I want you to understand what you're about to inherit. It's incredible what we can do. We have the most productive workers in the world, objectively, three times as productive as they are in Asia. We have the most agile venture capitalist system in the world. We have the greatest research universities in the world. There's more great research universities in the United States of America than the entire rest of the world combined because of Dwight Eisenhower. We're the epicenter of energy production and will remain so through this century. What are we looking down for? So it's time. It's time for America to get up. It's time for us once again to regain our sense of unity and purpose and remember who in God's name we are. With all the brain power and energy sitting in front of me, I know that nothing and no one can keep us from meeting our goals. It's time for your generation, your entire generation, to remember the admonition of my philosophy professor. I remember leaving, his name was Dr. Ingersoll. And as if I was supposed to know, he said, remember what Plato said, Joe. I'm thinking, what in the hell is that about? And Plato said, the penalty good people pay for not being involved in politics is being governed by people worse than themselves. Let me say that again. The penalty good people pay for not being involved in politics is being governed by people worse than themselves. So you have to engage. You have to be involved even in this dirty business of politics. You have to, for your own safety's sake. And I have no doubt you will, because you must. Thank you for having me. God bless you all, and may God protect our troops.
Thank you so much, Vice President Biden, for sharing your thoughtful words and inspiring leadership. Good afternoon. My name is Katie Wu. I'm a proud member of Cabot House, and it is an honor to serve as your second marshal. Class of 2017, we have made it. For a moment, think back to the person you were on the morning of August 26, 2013, move-in day. Now imagine sitting down for dinner with that person today. Each and every one of us has been shaped by someone else gathered here today. We have been comforted by late-night conversations with roommates and challenged by faculty members and classmates. We have felt the peaks and valleys that have come with changes in ourselves, our community, and the wider world. And as we fan out into all corners of the globe, class of 2017, let us continue to grow, form, and shape with each passing year. We do not go through this journey alone, and today we have much to be grateful for. Friends, family and faculty, thank you again for joining us to celebrate the culmination of this chapter of our lives. Now, it is my honor to introduce our Class Day Otis. The class ode is meant to reflect the spirit of our class. I am thrilled to welcome to the stage Bo Choi, Yukie Cody, Mary Rose Robson, Maddie Newman, Zoe Onion, Justin Dower, Andy Lee, and D.T. Wang, who will perform the ode. Please rise and join us in performing the class ode, sung to the tune of Fair Harvard. Lyrics can be found from inside your program. Thank you.
feast at Huntingmen made sure we survived as we grew in uniquely our way. We broke in the inn, laid claim to the quad, had the first these snow days ever known. Rakesh in the house's transformative squad gave the mission an inclusive tone. There, Harvard departing these Ivy Lakes halls towards the wilderness and the unknown. We will never forget how we learned in these walls that Lamont makes you feel so alone. And one last remark, our class has that spark where a class unlike any you see. So remember,